I want to talk to you today a little bit about an area of music performance that we call early music and also referred to sometimes as historical performance. And, you know, I have to say that when people ask me what my particular area is and I say early music, they often say, well, how young are the little ones that you teach? And everybody just assumes that we're talking about teaching kids. And of course, that would be early childhood education. But when we just put early music together, it kind of means something else. So really what we're talking about, and I'm going to go into more detail, but what we're basically talking about is music. Kind of, we think of early music as music sort of Bach and before, right? But we can expand that a little bit with the term historical performance, and I'll be talking about that in a second. But I also want to say that in that world, in the world of early music, historical performance, whatever you want to call it, I kind of wear several different hats. So I've been a musician my whole life. I was a rock musician, folk musician for many years. I got really interested in early music of medieval and Renaissance times, was fascinated by it, loved the way it sounded, wanted to know more about it. And so after proclaiming to everybody who'd listen that I would never go back to graduate school over my dead body, I brought my not dead body to graduate school when I was in my 30s to learn about early music. And because I decided I kind of wanted to go in that direction as a scholar and a performer. So I am a performer in that area, but I'm also a researcher in that area. That's my area of music at Tech. I teach classes that have to do with that. I teach some other classes too, but I teach classes that have to do with that. But in addition to that, about, well, let's see, 20 something years ago in 1991, almost 30 years, I started a radio program. I was working at the NPR station there at Indiana University, and I was an announcer at the station, at the classical station. And they asked me if I'd be interested in putting this show together about early music, because they knew that's what I was studying. And I said, sure, I'd love to. So unbeknownst to me, I mean, I could never imagine this at the time, but it ended up being syndicated so that stations all over the country could take it. And so I still host that show. We got a whole team of writers and everything, but I still host that show. And in fact, you can hear it on KTTZ on Monday nights at 10, if anybody's awake at that hour, but that's when they air it. Or you can stream it on the web too. So I guess what I'm driving at here is that I also am accustomed to telling people about early music by simply playing it for them and talking a little bit about it. So I kind of, excuse me, I kind of look at today as hopefully a kind of fun combination of those two things, where yes, it's a class and we're going to talk about things. I'm going to move on to my slideshow in a minute. But I also just want you to hear what this music is and to see pictures of some of the instruments that we use and hear what they sound like. So I'm kind of hoping that this will be fun many years ago, I was taking part in a medieval concert, some big school in the East, I think it was at Swarthmore, and we did this program of medieval Iberian music and Spanish music and medieval stuff. And at the end, a woman came up to me and she said she'd enjoyed it. And then she said, you know, I came here tonight to be educated, but I enjoyed myself. So I guess you can't do both. So I was happy that she could do both. So I'm kind of hoping that this will be the same situation, that, you know, we can learn some things and also just have fun listening to this music. So. All right, any questions before I get started? Great, Okay, so I'm going to just start sharing my screen here and go to my slides. And let's see. All right. See if it'll behave. There we go. All right. Here's some pictures. I'm going to try something because it's not quite behaving the way I want it to. Can you see? You can see the picture, right? If I just keep it this way. Yes. Hang on, I'm going to try this again. You know, there wouldn't be a Zoom presentation without at least some technical problem. So let me try this. There we go. All right, let's see if I can get that to work all right. We've got some early instruments here. If I can just point out some of these, you can see a couple of harps in the back. And on the extreme left-hand side, you see a slide trumpet, an early trumpet. Over on the right-hand side, on the upper level, you see something that looks kind of like a cello. That's what they call a viola da gamba. I'll say more about that later. We've got an assortment of drums here. And these wind instruments down on the ground, the black ones, are recorders. We can see the back of a lute. Actually, there's two lutes there. See the back and the front. I think there looks to me like there's a shawm in there too. You can barely see it, but we'll talk more about those later. So let me just say a few things about how we define this area of study that we call historical performance practice. Historical performance practice is basically an approach to early Western music. And by early Western music, I mean probably the vast majority of what falls into this category, or at least the way it first came about, is sort of Anglo-European music. We're talking about music of, when we say Western music, the music of Europe at this time anyway. And this approach to early Western music emphasizes the idea of studying a given piece of music in its original performance context. So what do we mean by its context? Well, you have its historical context in terms of what era is it from, what historical era, what was going on in the world when that music was being played, who would have heard it, and you know what place does it have in music history? Did it influence music that came later, and so on and so forth? You have the social aspects of a piece of music. Who would have listened to this piece of music? Who would have been in the audience? Who would have paid for this music? Was it paid for? Or is it a kind of thing where the musician was a kind of member of the household staff, as it were, who was paid with room and board and being supported in a kind of a patronage sort of situation. Who enjoyed that music? We can think of it in its cultural context by thinking of, for example, what function that music had. Was it sacred music? Is it something that belonged in a church setting? Was it music that would be used for social events? And if so, what kind of social event is this music people would have danced to? Is it music that people would have heard in the background while they were having a banquet? Is it music that would have been in more of a private sort of situation? Music that was written to put the king to sleep in the evening, you know, something like that. So all of that has some bearing on how the music was performed. And, you know, that can be important because, you know, a lot of these instruments that we're going to look at, they're not super loud instruments, or they have a certain kind of quality. And knowing and understanding where they were used and in what kind of situation they were used can be really important. I remember the first time I was in Ireland and we went to this castle, and they showed us that there was a little place that had been sort of built into the wall where the entertainers would have stood and played. And so, of course, you know, we were all musicians. We all climbed up there to see what it was like. And we noticed that even if we spoke in a whisper, people could hear us down in the great room below. And you think, well, I could have a tiny little medieval harp here. Everybody would be able to hear it just as clearly as anything. Now, if I'm in a great big modern performing space with carpeting all over the place, people say, well, you can't even hear that instrument. Well, it's different acoustics. And so these things can tell you a lot about the performance of a piece. So we study all of those types of things. And in addition, we also study, and this sort of is connected to what I was just saying, what did the music possibly sound like? What were the sonic qualities of the instruments that they were using? We hear, for example, we hear Bach now, and we have, you know, an orchestra that may play the Brandenburg concertos or something like that. But the instruments that Bach was using, if he was sitting there writing a piece and hearing the music in his head, the instruments that he was hearing in his head were not the instruments that we have now. Now you could argue, well, if he had the music, the instruments that we had now, he would have used those. I'm sure he would have. But a lot of this has to do with historical curiosity. You know, we have historical curiosity. What did the music sound like then? In the absence of any recording technology, we can't know for sure. So because we can't know for sure, and we're curious, and we have historical curiosity, we try to find out, using research and scholarship, some clues. And then we try to take those clues and apply them to the way we prepare performances. So for example, we might look at very early scores, the scores that were written out in by hand, and compare them to, you know, once they got the printing presses going, you know, how did that change the way notation looked? Extremely early notation looked to us, when we look at it, like a bunch of squiggles. And we might think, well, what good is that? Right? Doesn't even tell us what pitch it is. Well, those really early scores from the Middle Ages, some of them were really memory devices, memory aids, so that you could see the shape of the melody, and maybe that would jog your memory. So if the curve of the mark went up, it would be like going up in pitch, and if the curve were going down, it would be going down in pitch, and this sort of thing, just to kind of remind you how the shape of that melody was. And we can also look at other kinds of primary sources, like practical or theoretical treatises that people wrote. So let me just randomly choose one. So if you look at, here's one, a source called The New Music, Le Nuove Musique, from 1601. A fellow named Giulio Caccini wrote this. He was very well known in his area of Italy, sort of a famous guy. And he was a singer and a harpist, and he came from a whole family of musicians. And he wrote this book that had a collection of his compositions in it. But at the beginning of the book, he basically said, this is how we sing this music. This is how we sing what we're calling the new music. For him, it was new, cutting edge, progressive stuff. And so he carefully wrote out the kinds of ornaments that they used. When I want somebody to do a trillo, he calls it a trillo, this is what I want you to do. We think it's, oh, a trillo, it's a trill. No, it wasn't a trill. It was something that was more like a repercussion. that kind of thing. That probably couldn't really come out very well in my microphone. Let me back up a little bit. There's a repercussion in the note, right? And that's what he's calling a trillo. We have other evidence also that's contemporary with any particular era of the music's composition. So we know, for example, that at carrying on with Caccini here, that this vocal music that he was writing would have been accompanied by not a piano, they didn't have pianos yet, but it would have been accompanied by a lute or a harp or probably some kind of stringed instrument, any instrument that could play chords. So, so these are the kinds of things that we look at, and we try to put together performances that kind of cater to our historical curiosity so that we can say, how do we think this music did sound? And what evidence do we have that it did sound that way? It's kind of like opening a little window to the past and looking at it. But above all, and I think this is really important for those of us who perform early music, you look at all of that to create not just something that's going to sound like a museum piece, but you want it to create performances for today's audiences that people are going to enjoy, so that even though you have this gap of centuries, the communication between the musicians and the listeners is still strong and you still have an engaging performance. Let me just share something else here so I can pause. Let's see, stop sharing, I'm gonna share something else. Anybody got questions before I share a couple of things I want you to listen to? Okay, let me move on here. Okay, I think this is what I'm trying to share. Great, okay. I want you to listen to a couple things here. This is, let me move this so I can see it. Hang on. There we go. This is a recording of Bach's Brandenburg Concerto number 2. And it's pretty straightforward. It's the LA Philharmonic. And let's just listen to it for a second and see what it sounds like. Lovely. It's hard to just pause these things, right? Just when you're getting into it. But what you're hearing there is modern instruments. This piece is often played when we have a modern orchestra. It's played on a piccolo trumpet. And we have a flute and a violin. And those are kind of the soloists that you hear. This is called a concerto grosso because you have a large group, the whole orchestra, and then it sort of, you have these sections where the soloists are featured. So that alternation between the large group and the small group, which was called concertato style and was very, very popular during the Baroque era, this is something that Bach was going for here. But let's hear that again and watch here the from the BBC Proms.
And now Sir John Eliot Gardner conducts the English Baroque soloists in Bach's Brandenburg Concerto No. 2.
And now you're going to the historical instrument. So I have so many things to play for you today. We'd be here till next week, but we played them all the way through. So let me stop sharing that one. Does anybody have any questions so far about those two things that we just listened to? I talked a little bit in between the two to just kind of prepare you for what you're going to hear. So have any of you ever, do I have any musicians here in the crowd? One of the things that you might notice is that they sounded like they were in two different keys. They were at a different pitch level, one from the other. And that's sometimes startling to musicians. They're used to hearing something at a certain, they say, what are they doing with that? They transposed it to a different key or a different, let's call it a different pitch level. So that instead of starting on one particular note, it seems like it's starting on a completely different note. Well, it actually has not been transposed, but one of the things that we discovered when we started studying about early performance is that they use different pitch standards. So what we call A, which is a note that happens to vibrate at 440 cycles per second, They had a note they called A, but it wasn't 440. In many places, it was 415. Now to our ears, that sounds like an A flat. So when they tune all of the instruments to this new pitch level, it gives it a whole different quality. It gives the instruments a slightly different timbre and color, and it really can sound quite different. There are other elements too that you might have heard. First of all, the historical instruments have a very different quality. The historical trumpet had a different quality to the sound. Joyce is asking, what was the trumpet-like instrument? It was a trumpet. It was just a very early Baroque trumpet before they used valves. So you may have noticed that he was fingering. It almost looked like part of the tubular structure of the instrument had holes in it. And he was fingering the notes there and also using a lot of lip manipulation to get the different notes. Just a very difficult instrument to play. And that person is just a virtuoso player. And then the Baroque oboe, you'll notice that it was a different kind of wood, different shape slightly, different kinds of reeds. Instead of the flute, they would have used the recorder. And, you know, you could tell, I'm sure, just from listening to the small excerpt that we heard from that recorder player, that we're not talking about your fourth grader with the see-through plastic green recorder here. You know, so it's a very, very serious instrument that took a lot of virtuosic ability. So both of those recordings, lovely. Both of those recordings, virtuoso players, but they sound different. And the reason they sound different is because they made different sorts of decisions about the recording, the performance, based on some historical research. And the second group just made the decision all the time, because that's kind of their specialty, to use the historical Baroque instruments. And that alone will make this sound very different. And they also use different sorts of articulations, different ideas about dynamics, different ideas about tempo. You'll notice the second one was a bit faster than the first one. So all of these things that they researched through reading treatises and writings of the time, everything from musicians' accounts to instruction books to firsthand witnesses of people who listen to these things, and we just gather all of this research together. So it's quite interesting. Going back to my slide here, any other questions yet? Okay. All right. So, there were a couple of other things. I'm glad I wrote myself this note, because there were a couple of other things that I wanted you to hear. So actually, I've got to stop sharing this because I'm sharing the wrong thing. Let's go back to our YouTube thing. Okay. This is something completely different. I mentioned this fellow, Giulio Caccini, who wrote this, the instructions on how to sing the pieces in his 1601 book. I thought it would be fun to listen to one of those, probably the most famous song in the book. And many people who take classical voice lessons have to sing this at some point. And this is they're both gorgeous performance of this piece. They're just very different from one another. The first one is Cecilia Bartoli, and this is called Amarilli Mia Bella. And I want you, before we start listening to it, to just realize that she's singing and she has a piano accompanying her. So the piano, a piano part has been written for the piece. Now you might say, what do you mean has been written? Didn't Caccini write some kind of accompaniment? Well, he did, but the accompaniment that Caccini wrote was just a bass line with some numbers above it that indicated the chords that he wanted the accompanist to play. So right there, that tells us something about what was happening, what tells us that you could perform it one day with one accompanist and you could play it the next day with an accompanist playing a different instrument, and it might sound quite different. And this particular kind of accompanimental style, which is sometimes called continuo or figured bass, is very typical of Baroque music. But many times in the modern era, somebody who studied the theory of continuo or figured bass would figure, now, you know, the performer's not going to want to sit there and spend 2 hours figuring this out. So we're going to write out a beautiful piano part for the accompanist to play. And so when we publish the music, it's going to have the original melody that Caccini wrote in there. And then we're going to put this lovely piano part in it. Great. It works great. And that would be something along the lines of what you're going to hear right here, if I can get a start. Thank you. on a sec. So, okay, just gorgeous. And you'll notice right at the end, actually, she did one of those little trillo or ornaments that I was telling you about with a little repercussion. So beautiful, virtuosic performance of that piece, absolutely beautiful. So if we put on our historical curiosity hat for a minute, and we say, well, okay, just out of curiosity, probably wouldn't have had a piano, definitely wouldn't have had a piano, they weren't invented yet. So what kind of instrument might they have used? What kind of instrument might Caccini have had in mind when he was writing these bass notes with chords? Well, probably either a harp or the thing that you can see in front of you here, which is called a theorbo. It's a large lute, kind of a large lute-like instrument that has some of these bass strings added to it. And the other thing that's kind of interesting about it is that it may have been sung certainly by a soprano, but it would have been just as likely in Caccini's time to be sung by a male with a very high voice. So let's, you know, what would that have been like? Let's check this out. Okay. Sorry if you heard some, I wasn't sharing the screen, but the next piece decided it was going to play, so I had to stop it. What did we call that instrument? The instrument, actually I'm gonna type it in there, it's a theorbo. And it's a kind of large lute, remarkably light, somewhat unwieldy if you're standing to the left of the player, since it sticks out about 6 feet, the original social distancing instrument. gorgeous sound to it. It is those very beautiful, deep, low bass notes that it had. And it was an extremely popular instrument for the accompaniment of song in the early Baroque and even into the middle Baroque period. Any other questions? Any questions about the countertenor who was singing, Philip Jaruski? The countertenor voice, there's actually, when people started really getting into the historical research and studying these high voice male singers, they found that actually the countertenor is one type of voice. There were also, we also talk about male altos and male sopranos as opposed to countertenors. And it all has to do with how they, let's see, to try to sort of put this in plain and simple terms, it has to do with how they're working with their falsetto voice and how they're working with their regular head voice and chest voice. So it has a lot to do with placement. It has a lot to do with the natural quality of the voice. It always interested me that when we started to get these recordings with male singers singing extraordinarily high, you know, some of this classical repertoire, people were sort of surprised by it. And then I think, you know, in popular music, we have males singing in an extraordinarily high voice all the time. You know, everybody from Smokey Robinson to, you know, some of the sort of rock and roll screamers like Robert Plant is super high. So it's not something that didn't exist. I mean, it's existed. In different kinds of music, but we weren't necessarily used to hearing it in that particular setting. So what instruments do I play? Oh, two good questions here. What instrument do I play? I was primarily a singer. My first instrument was piano. So I play keyboards. I play guitar. And there's a bunch of instruments that I play at, I'm going to put it that way. Taking early music, I learned the rudiments of a number of instruments. So I play a little bit of early harp, a little bit of hurdy-gurdy, different plucked string instruments, mostly strings and keyboards and sing. But yeah, thanks for asking. The difference in this guy in castrati, and it's, you put spelling there, but it's spelled absolutely right. The castrato was a phenomenon in the Baroque era. It was something that happened when young boys who had extremely promising voices had, let's just say, surgery in order to preserve their high voices. So they would grow to manhood, still having an extraordinarily high voice, but having the physical chest cavity and, you know, a bigger body of an adult. And what we are told is that they had incredibly powerful voices. And so, especially in Italian opera, they were used all the time, many times for lead heroic roles in Italian opera. They were rock stars in Italy. It's kind of, you know, almost unbelievable to us now. It was a phenomenon that was particularly common in Italy. The French, not so much. They thought the Italians were a little off there. but it's something that persisted in church music. There were castrati still singing church music all the way up into the 19th century. That's a whole phenomenon that is an incredibly interesting and disturbing subject. There was a rather famous film. By the way, I think Philip, I couldn't swear to this, but I think Philip Jaruski still has all of his equipment. there was a well-known film called Farinelli. And it was one of these sort of fictionalized biographies of a very famous castrato singer from Italy, who was known by his last name of Farinelli, and he was a big sensation in the time. And it's actually a very sad movie, very dramatic, gorgeous costumes, lots of spectacle, and absolutely incredible singing. So if you're looking for something to Netflix, I don't know where I'm sure there's somewhere you can get this film to see, but it's a very interesting film historically. Okay, so let me go back to my slideshow here. Okay, so let me just say a few things about what historical performance isn't. We've talked a little bit about what it is and exploring music with our historical curiosity and so on. But, when the world of historical performance began, it really began to be a movement, especially in the 50s and 60s and 70s. And a lot of people had a lot of ideas about it. And some people became very interested in this idea of trying to play a piece exactly as it was played and heard in, such and such a year. So, we want to hear Caccini the way it would have sounded in 1601. Well, first of all, one of the words that they would use for this was, this is an authentic performance. Seems to be, eventually we decided that's a fairly problematic term, because what does authentic mean? What does an authentic performance mean? I mean, if a performer is doing a beautiful job and it's coming from the heart and they've studied and they've done all this, what's not authentic about that, right? So the other problem is, so the word itself is problematic, but also we may think that we've done all of this research and we're playing a piece exactly as it would have been played and exactly as it would have sounded in such and such a year. But honestly, how can we know that? We have no recordings. We don't necessarily know every detail. We don't necessarily know who was singing it. We can do all this research and we can make educated guesses. But to say that we can play a piece exactly the way it was played and heard in, 1371, not so much. I mean, when you think about it, how can we really know? I want to kind of illustrate this with, it's not quite a game, but it's something that's fun to look at. This is a picture of a musical score from the 14th century, a piece written by Landini, an Italian composer named Francesco Landini. And it's called Ecco la Primavera, Behold the Springs. One of these very happy sort of spring has sprung and everyone's happy and, happiness and love is in the air, this sort of thing. Well, first of all, we look at it and we'll say, if we're approaching this from historical performance, we say, well, what is on this page? There are notes on the page. So we know what pitches are being sung. This particular kind of notation also tells us the rhythm of the notes. And I might add, not all of it does from the Middle Ages, but this does. So luckily, we know that it's going to go not just bum, 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 bum. I mean, not just the pitches, but ecco la primavera. We know what the rhythm's going to be. Okay, so that's good. But we have to look at it a little bit because it isn't set up the way our music is in terms of its linear presentation. So it turns out that actually there are two voice parts here. It looks like one melody that just goes to the end of the page, but it isn't. Right in the middle of the second line, the second sort of set of, the second staff, let's put it that way, right in the middle of the second staff, there's this sort of ornate vertical line. And that line is telling us this is the beginning of the second voice part. Now, in our modern notation, we would have set the first part up on one staff, and then we would have put the second voice part underneath it, like choral music is written. But they didn't do that. It's one of these things where they kind of figured that you knew what you were doing, so they just wrote it out this way. Also, instead of setting all of the words very neatly underneath the proper notes, the second verse is just written at the very end. You can see all of this, even if you can't read the letters, you can tell that there's all this verbiage sort of, you know, thrown in there at the end. That's the second verse. So what do we have here? We have a melody for one voice, and we have a melody for another voice. We have a bunch of words. We have no indication of whether instruments would have played along or not. People who study music of this era can recognize from the form of the music, and by the form, I mean what the poetic form of the words is, where it repeats, and this sort of thing. We can tell that it's a type of music called a ballata, which comes from the word ballare, which means dance. So ballatas were very popular in 14th century Italy. And the circumstances in which they would have been performed have been described many times. And this was entertainment. I don't know how many of you have read, there's a famous book from that century by an Italian writer named Boccaccio, and it's called The Decameron. And in The Decameron, it's basically the story of a bunch of young people. This is quite appropriate to our circumstance. It's about a bunch of young people who leave Florence during the plague, during the Black Plague, and they go up to the villa that belongs to somebody's family, and they decide that they're just going to shelter in place and wait it out. Wait out the plague until the plague leaves Florence. So there they are, and they have to have something to amuse themselves since they can't binge watch things. So what they do is they set up this very elaborate system where each of them tells a story on a particular day. So they spend their time telling stories to each other, dancing, singing, and they have some instruments with them too. And one of the neat things about that book is that even though it doesn't have any musical notation in it, it's an amazing snapshot of musical practice. What would a bunch of kids in a villa in the 14th century waiting out the plague, what would they have done to amuse each other? And so there are these lovely descriptions of, you know, so-and-so played the fiddle while so-and-so danced. And then this other guy brought his bagpipes in and played a little bit, you know, at the end of the piece and so on. So we get this wonderful information about the circumstances of some of these pieces being played, but that still doesn't tell us what it sounded like. So what are we doing? We're making educated guesses. And we're also saying, all right, here's our criteria here. We want to make something that people are going to enjoy listening to. We'd like it to have some kind of historical verisimilitude, even though it may not be exactly the way it sounded. We want to be presenting something with at least with some awareness of historically what might have been the case. But even within that, you have a huge array of possibilities. So you could get 3, 4, 5, 6, this piece has been recorded dozens of times and they're all different. So I thought it would be fun anyway, to explain what I mean by they're all different. So I think in order to make this work, there we go. All right. So here's one version.
Ecco la primavera, per comparare grane, per innamorare, e sto con lieta cena, dove già la mariana il tempo, che pur chiama l'allegrezza, in questo bavo. L'erbe con grande freschezza e fioco prono i prati e gli alberi adornati sono in simili bandera. Ecco la primavera che con farà negrare tempe da innamorare e sta con lieta.
Okay, so I'm just going to stop that here and then go on to the next version, exactly the same piece. Let's see if I did this right. Yep. Before I go on to the next one, I just want to mention that, what are we hearing? It's the same melody, couple voices, but there's all kinds of instruments that have been brought into the mix. So we hear some drums, we hear some of the reed instruments called shams. I hear a recorder playing all kinds of ornaments. Some of the instruments are not playing the notes that are on this page at all. They're playing sort of harmonies and parallel lines and this sort of thing. So there's really quite a lot of performer input into exactly what's going on here with the arrangement. Here's another one. And let's see, will it just play if I do this? Yes, it will.
No, they can't lie. Tempo, tempo, come on.
right there. So you may not have been expecting bagpipes there at the end, but there's, by the way, bagpipes were a very, very common instrument in medieval times, in the Renaissance, and they were not all Scottish Highland bagpipes. There were many, many variations. There were English pipes. There were variations on bagpipes found all over, practically all over the globe, but they were found in variations on them in almost every European country. So people make a whole historical study of bagpipes alone. It's quite fascinating. What I find interesting about this, there's a passage in that same book that I was talking to you about, the Decameron, where the narrator says, they had a lovely time and they, you know, so-and-so told a story, and then two of them played the viol and the lute, and they played and sang and danced a lovely ballata. And at the end of the ballata, one of the servants comes out with the bagpipes and joins them on the bagpipes. And I've wondered many times when I hear this recording, if the people who made the recording had read that book and were, you know, here's a famous ballata, and what if we did it the way Boccaccio described in the Decameron, what would it sound like? So that's sort of fun. sometimes people will leave the world of early music. Let me, I might want to add that you'll notice that there's a lot of different styles of singing that you're hearing here. So some of it sounds more like what we might think of as popular music voice or a folk singing voice. It's a little bit hard to determine exactly what kinds of vocal techniques people use then, but we certainly know that it was not the same in every region in Europe. There were regional styles, just as there are in folk music now. And they sort of had a different way of thinking about voice, instead of the fact that there should be this one overarching quote unquote right way to sing. There may be a right way to sing in terms of how to healthily produce a tone, but in terms of what that tone should sound like, we believe there were a lot of very strong regional differences. This is pretty interesting. We'll listen to this here for a minute.
Ecco la primavera che il cor farà allegrare, tempi da innamorare e star con vita c'era. Nove giallaria è il tempo che pur chiama allegrezza. Nove giallaria è il tempo che pur chiama allegrezza.
Here we've got a little rock and roll version of this, although there's nothing electric about any of the instruments that they're playing, which is kind of interesting to think about. You know, if you have enough drums and bagpipes and percussive string instruments, you know, who needs electricity, right? Still sounds like rock and roll. But what we do have there is a whole accompanimental section that has been completely created by the performers. It's not anywhere on this page. Okay, so I'm going to stop the share for a minute. Okay, thanks. I was just looking in the chat. Thank you. Thanks a lot. I hope I can answer some of these questions later that were just sent to me. Let me ask you, so I'll just hold that thought. Anybody got any observations or comments that they want to make about this? Gonna open the floor for questions for a second. I always have hesitations a little bit about playing the same song four times, but it really proves a point, which is that the earlier you go, the more the performance itself, the more aspects of the performance itself get left up to the performers, right? So you have a situation much later, and certainly in the Brandenburg, I mean, those notes are all written down. Bach wrote them all down. And you go back 300 years and you've just got the melody. Almost, when you think about it, it's kind of like a jazz chart, right? You just have the melody and maybe the chords. Well, you don't have the chords in Ecco la Primavera, but you had the chords with the Caccini piece. So, you know, it's very interesting. What it means, among other things, is that this idea that music is an oral tradition, the farther back in time you go, the more that's true. And even when they start writing down music, it's interesting to think about how the person who was writing down the music decided what to write. Well, they would write down whatever they felt was important to identify that piece as that particular song, right? So some really interesting things to think about in terms of performance and in terms of how much improvisation there was and how much sort of spontaneous composition and how much arrangement there was in putting together a performance that really gave a lot of the agency up to the performer instead of the composer. And, you know, you go back to the Middle Ages and, you know, you're fortunate if you know who the composer was, and half of them just, you know, aren't even identified. So very interesting aspects to it historically. I'm going to show you some pictures of some cool instruments in a minute. Anybody have any questions? Okay, let me go over to the screen. You know, I think actually, let's see, how shall we do this? I'm going to go through these pretty quickly. And I may pause to play examples here and there. Let me get my own. There we go. Okay. All right. I'm going to scroll back to the first page of this. And as I said, I'm going to zip through this pretty quickly, but and I'm going to go way back in time to the Middle Ages. This is an instrument that we might call a medieval fiddle, also sometimes called the viol. I'm going to ask you something. If I play this, I'm just going to ask you for a little show of hands here. Can you hear it? Anything there? Yes, no? Sounds like no. Okay. I want you to hear one of these medieval fiddles, so I'm just going to share something different. Here we go. Boy, you have to hit a lot of buttons to do this. There we go.
Gloria, nato de Virgine qui
pause it there, go back here. So I have to stop sharing this. I just wanted you to hear that. As I said, I'm going to sort of flip through these pretty quickly. We also have some small stringed instruments, medieval bowed string instruments, that were shaped more like the Middle Eastern bowed string instruments, like the rebec, which looks very much like an instrument called the rabab that is found in Middle Eastern instruments. Here's some pictures of other sort of modern reproductions. I think some of these might be a bit fanciful, but it's a little hard to tell from the pictures. If you see, you know, the pictures that we work from weren't always terribly realistic. Sorry about that. Okay. What's going on here? There we go. Here's an interesting instrument called the crwth. It's still actually used in Welsh traditional music today. As you can see, it's an unusual shape played with a bow. Here's a lyre next to a crwth. And this is actually, the picture is just a bunch of us holding some of these instruments many, many, many years ago. But the picture on the right-hand side can tell you what some of them look like. Harps were found in all shapes and sizes, little ones, mostly in the Middle Ages. And we can see a variety of them here. Here's some modern reproductions and what they look like. Again, slightly different shapes, but all basically way smaller than a modern orchestral harp. This is a picture of a lyre. And the fellow holding the lyre is a performer named Ben Bagby, who has this magnificent performance of Beowulf that he does as if he were a bard, Anglo-Saxon bard, and he's got it memorized. And honestly, you get to the point where you're not even looking at the translation anymore because he's such a good actor. But they would have used the lyre for that kind of thing, the epic storytelling. Here's a lute, early medieval lute, descended again from a Middle Eastern instrument called the oud. And down in the lower right-hand corner, we have an interesting picture of a couple of Middle Eastern players now and with an instrument that looks for all the world like the instrument in the medieval illustration right above it. So some of these instruments still have modern descendants to this day. Every once in a while, we luck out and we find a medieval or Renaissance treatise that actually has the plans for an instrument. And of course, the historical instrument builders just love this because they can follow the plans exactly and then, you know, build the instrument as if it were built, you know, as if it weren't something that they have to dig up in a museum. So this is really quite fun. Here are some other medieval lutes. They're smaller and have fewer strings than the Renaissance lutes. Here's an interesting instrument called a gittern. It has these sort of little points, kind of like I said here, it's like a teeny little Stratocaster. but we find these instruments in some illustrations in European sources, like in France and Spain in particular. Here's an interesting instrument, the hurdy-gurdy, also sometimes called the sinfonia. I'm gonna go through these and then I'm gonna play you a couple of examples of these. Here's a psaltery, sometimes played with sort of hammers and sometimes plucked. The shawm is a reed instrument that is incredibly loud. And here are some medieval recorders. You can see they're a different shape than the later recorders are. Very soft and sweet instruments. They did have side-blown flutes, but they weren't the same as ours today. They didn't have keypads and and keys and all that sort of thing. They were just holes. And bagpipes, there were all kinds of bagpipes in that time as well. Let me just advance. Oh, this is an example of these cute little organettos that they had, which was basically an organ, but it was held on the lap. And the way you would play it, you can kind of see here, is that you can see in the right-hand picture here, the player would be playing with one hand and working the bellows with the other hand. So that's a lot of fun as well. Here's a slide trumpet. Looks a little bit like the trumpet that person was playing in the Brandenburg. Here are some instruments that are called viols. They're all different sizes. They would build these things in families. We're getting into the Renaissance now. So you have instruments that are essentially the same construction, but they're built in different sizes to play music that's basically soprano, alto, tenor, bass, like choral music would be, only for instruments. Here's another picture of a viol. I'm gonna skip over a few of these here. Renaissance wind instruments, because we'll hear some of these. Crumb horns, which is sound a little bit like amplified kazoos, these beautiful curved instruments. Shams, and other reed instruments, very loud, built in different sizes. More recorders, and we can see the huge variety of sizes in which they are to be found. And here's an instrument called a cornetto, which is very difficult to play, but very sweet sounding. And it's a big brother, the serpent, or the bass cornetto. And here's some other funny little wind instruments. We have the early trombone, which was known as the sackbut. So I'm gonna stop there with these Renaissance instruments because I wanna make sure that we have time for you to hear a few of these things. So I'm gonna stop the share and very quickly just play a couple of things for you. Here it is. Okay, let me move down to a couple of things I'd like you to hear. This is what I want you to see. Stop that there, because I want to kind of sample these. I tried to pick some instruments here that I thought you might have not ever heard before, because that could be interesting. This is one of those little organettos. Popular with my students. They all decide that they want one instantly when they see it. Here is Renaissance version of the string quartet there. Stop that one. Go back to the Spotify list here. And play a little bit for you of, where's my in here? Here's some of those wind instruments. I want to make sure that, I mean, I know this has only been a very brief sampling, right, of different sorts of sounds that you hear with these early instruments and so on. It's hard to really, in 90 minutes, you could just about scratch the surface, but I wanted to leave at least 5 or 6 minutes for people to ask questions if we'd like to.
To go ahead and unmute everybody's microphones so y'all can go ahead and ask questions.
Sure. Maybe a show of hands, are these instruments new to people?
Colleen?
Yeah.
Some of you asked questions very specifically to me. And I don't know if you wanted to me to answer them privately or to the group or how do you usually do that, Tina?
So normally, if anybody asks questions, probably you have the same question. So feel free to just to answer them. I obviously, if it was private, I can't read it. Otherwise, I would. And then have you answer it. So if you would mind. Read us the question and answer it.
I didn't quite get the end of that because we've got the echo problem. But
echo.
Well, Linda was remarking that. When you Google these things, that they do come up. And yes, they do. Google will recognize them and bring them up for you. There are a lot of recordings of early music on Spotify, on YouTube, and many, many of them are pretty straightforward and easy to find. Also, I think, let's see, let me send this to everyone. The name of the book that I mentioned by Boccaccio is called The Decameron. And let's see. There's Boccaccio. Whoops. Trying to type too fast. There we go. So thank you. I'm glad that some of you enjoyed the time traveling. That is one of the nice aspects of it, is that you just get that little window into the past. Any other questions? Let's see, I think it's about 3:27. Tina, should I just end with some music or
Yeah, that would be lovely. So again, I apologize. I don't know why there was such an echo. I was trying to mute and unmute to try to see if I could correct it. So I do apologize. If anybody has any further questions, you know, now would be a great time to ask. If not, we can certainly contact Angela at another time and see if maybe she could kind of email us some things. But so I'm just going to ask one more time. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
I can address the last couple of things here. Colleen, thank you for saying that you could listen to a whole concert of this stuff. We have many of them at Tech. I direct a group called, and I'll type it in here, the Texas Tech Collegium Musicum. And we do concerts almost every semester. And it's a wide variety of music from medieval times to the early Baroque era. We use a lot of historical instruments. Tech does have a small but really cool collection of early instruments that we use. As you can imagine, we're kind of on hiatus this semester because of the whole COVID thing, but we plan to be back next semester. And in fact, we'll be back either in person or we'll try to put something together that can be found on YouTube and do it kind of, you know, recording each other and double tracking each other or whatever. And if we do that, the current plan is to do some more of the music from the same time period as the Decameron. So that'll be fun. That's our plan for next semester. And yes, so I will absolutely let you all know if it's on YouTube. And also we'll let you know if it's live, which I imagine it would either be in Hemley or over in Hans Chapel, probably one of those two, or maybe sometimes we do our concerts at St. John's. It depends on that. We have a question about when is my next OLLI course? Thanks, Ross. You tell me. Okay, this was really fun. I'd be happy to do it again. Happy to, you know, bring you on this little time traveling journey. Again, the radio program that I do is on Monday nights at 10 o'clock on KTTZ, which is kind of late, but the program is also streamed. Let me just type in here the name of it. And if you put this, Harmonia, Early Music on Public Radio. If you type that into Google, it will bring up the website of the radio show. And there are links where you can listen to some of the programs, and it's, you know, open to the public and listen to them, and or you can stream it. It's on a lot of stations, so some of them don't air it at 10 o'clock at night, so you can, you'll find a list there, so. Thank you so much. I really enjoyed this. It was a lot of fun.
Well, Angela, thank you so much for presenting. It was a great class and very interesting, and I love this music. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
And with that, I just want to again tell everybody thank you for joining us, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.